Betty, she called a while ago and said, well, texted a while ago and said she had a problem with her leg, Betty Dent. I remember all of that family. And remember the Meadow family. And remember all the sick and shut in and all the lost. Now, is anybody on? Go ahead, Sharon.
Meet all my family.
Okay. Okay. All right, Joe.
Remember me, I have surgery tomorrow.
And now tell us what you're going to have done.
Yeah,
okay. Is that outpatient? Okay. Anybody else on this side? All right, how about on this side?
Remember Judy Angel, Stink.
Judy Stink?
And Justin Athena.
Okay, Jody? Yeah, he got the COVID. It'll take about 3 weeks to get straightened out of it, what it took me. Right, okay. Sue? Mandy? Okay. All righty.
Remember Jack's youngest big boy, Oakley? Evidently, his mama's side of the family all got COVID. I don't know exactly what it is, but.
Okay. All right. Anything else? We'll go to the Lord in prayer. All right. How about unspoken requests? That's all we'll stand at can. And I'll lead us out this morning. Heavenly Father, we come before the throne of grace right now. We ask that your blessed Holy Spirit will just reach down, touch every heart and every life and every soul. And Lord, we pray that the anointing hand of Almighty God, the healing power of your precious Holy Spirit, will reach down and touch every heart and every life and every soul. Lord, we just pray that your Holy Spirit bless and hand each and every one. Lord, it's going through a trying time, who's having a difficult time in their physical body. Lord, we pray that the Holy Spirit would reach out and touch every heart. And Lord, we just commit everything into your hand, that your will would be done. And Lord, for those about ready to slip into eternity, Lord, we pray they've made it right. Lord, we ask that your precious Holy Spirit, Lord, heal all manner of sickness and disease. Lord, it's in your gracious holy name we pray and ask it all. And let all of God's children say, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Go ahead, Dr. Calvin, and pray over the tithing offering. Amen. Anybody have a testimony they want to share with us this morning? Something God's done in your life? Don't everybody speak at once. Oh, okay. Well, that's good. Hallelujah. That's for sure. That's for sure. Without him, we can do nothing. But with him, we can do all things. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Glory be, glory be, glory be. Anybody else? Room, despair, and agony on me. If it wasn't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Oh, my God. They look like a bunch of people fit to be hung. Are we on trial this morning for something? I hope we don't have to put a coat hanging on our mouth to get a smile going. You think you had it hard. Y'all see what happened yesterday. I rode down the road, you'd have been to somebody I hadn't visited for a long time, so you got four goats down there, And they had a real pillar down there. All four of them goats is up on the rock. I don't understand why they want to get up on the rock and lay down and sleep. All right, did anybody have a birthday this past week? Nobody had anniversary? Have anniversary? All right, let's all stand and can invite the presence of the Holy Spirit in this house. Heavenly Father, we thank you this day for the opportunity to be in thy house. Lord, we ask that the blessings of Almighty God be upon everything that's said and done here today. Lord, we commit this service into thy hand. And Lord, I pray that we'll get some fire down in our bosom, down in our heart, down in our feet, down in our hands, down in our soul. Lord, we'll honor you and praise you and glorify your holy name and worship you. Lord, we invite everybody by way of Facebook or whatever to join in with us this morning. Lift up your hands and praise and glorify the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, because one day we're going to see him as he is. Praise, Lord, be into his holy name. It could happen any day, so let us give him praise right now. And let everybody that has the breath of life praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
I heard about his grace. 391, 391.
Send the light, Jesus.
There's a call come ringing over the rim. Send a light. There's a call coming over the restless waves. Send a light. Send a light. There are souls to rest. There are souls to sing. Send a light. Ready to leave this world.
I could get by myself.
I've learned cause I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
It is one of these days. Like I said, one of these days. If you have your Bibles, turn to book number 27. Which is the book of Daniel. Hallelujah. The book of Daniel, chapter 2, book number 27. Now, everybody knows about the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But how many of you all know their real names? That was a Babylonian name was gave to them because they was very, very intelligent young men. And back in this day and time, they wanted to change their customs. They wanted to change them. But when you think about how faithful these three young men were to God, and we're talking about children somewhere in the age of about 15, 16, 17 years old. These are not old men. They had, the old man was Daniel, but he wasn't really, he was probably about 40 at that time. So I had all of them just about. If I didn't, Thurston definitely did. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But anyway, in the second chapter, in verse 17, it says, "Then Daniel went to his house and made the thing known unto Hananiah," this is Shadrach, Mishael, that was Abednego, no, I mean Shadrach, this was Meshach, and Azariah was Abednego. Now what the king wanted to do was take them and make them do what he wanted done. So now go up to chapter 3 and verse 12. Now the king had set up an image, and any time they seen this image set up, they had to bow to it, or if they heard the music playing. Like when Willie Nelson sings, he makes everybody stand up. I'll put you to sleep, one or the other. No, I'm just kidding. But this was demanded, and they were supposed to do this every time. Now let's bring this thing kind of where we're at today. Your faith is going to be tried like these three boys and Daniel. You can believe that. Your faith is going to be tried to see what you're really made out of. Now these three young men, they had been taught the ways of God from their childhood up. That fulfills Proverbs 22:6. Train a child up in the way he should go, and when he's old, if he departs from the faith, he'll find his way back. So we really need young people today to be in the house of God. Because people like me and Robert ain't going to be around here too much longer, because our 3 score and 10, we don't run over that boundary. But anyway, that's up to God. Hallelujah. All right, chapter 3 and verse 12 says, "There are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the providence of Babylon." Now, these men were like mayors or governors. This ruthless, wicked king seen something in these three young men. So he's trying to change everything about them. So what he does, he says, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, these men, O king, have no regard thee. They serve not thy God, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." Now, how many people today in the government would buck the president? This is what they done. "We don't care what you set up out there for us to worship. We're not going to do it." Now, this is built into these three young men at an early age. Hallelujah. Because their faith right here is going to carry them into a terrible situation, but it's going to bring them out of a terrible situation. Your faith is going to be tried and tested. Hallelujah. Joe Biden is trying to test our faith today about a thing called a shot. So many people don't want to fool with that. Hallelujah. He's talking about certain places in certain states now that you cannot buy anything unless you have proof of the shot. You can't go into a certain place. What is that? It's identical what's taking place right here. But who's going to deliver us? This is what is dividing the country. It is not about black and white. Really get this now. It's not about the color. Because there's a lot of black people love God. There's a lot of people all around the world love God. It's not about the color. They're trying to put this right here to divide it. And the Jews, they didn't want, Babylon didn't want, they left them in exile, meaning they didn't have anything going on for them. The reason we're going through things we're going through right now is these governors don't have enough grit to stand up. But there's two halves in Texas and Florida. What do we got down here? He'll kill a baby and tell her to wear a mask to save our lives. Does that make any sense? What kind of leadership we have? When you pull a baby out of a woman, let it lay on a table and say, well, I don't need it any longer, put it in a can and throw it away. Or make some cold cream out of it or this, that, and other. Our faith is going to be tried and tested. These three men, they would not allow that faith carried them into the furnace. It carried them into the fire. And we in the fire right now, a lot of us don't understand that. We're going to go through trials and tests like we never have before. Because I don't see no great revival coming to America. And I'm going to tell you why. It's because America has been saturated with the gospel for the last 150 years. What have they done with it? It's got thrown away. It's got pushed out. It's that and other. How many people today will bow to anything your government tells them to do? How many people have got the grit to stand? How many people today will even go in a restaurant and pray over their meal? How many people will witness on the street? How many people will do anything for God? They're afraid they're going to offend somebody. I don't care who I offend. I mean that for death. I'm not just saying that because I'm standing up here. I don't care who I offend. Because I'm going to stand. I'm going to stand for Jesus. Hallelujah. I don't care what the world thinks about me. I don't care what the world sees in me. It doesn't make any difference because God told me this week, he said, son, the closer it gets to the rapture, the harder it's going to be for you to get there. Because they're going to throw everything they've got at you. Hallelujah. And we see it coming. We see it coming. Those who have spiritual eyes sees what's coming. But those who don't have spiritual eyes, 2 Corinthians 4 and 4 says, the God of this world has blinded their eyes. Hallelujah. And the church is going to soon be judged if it's not going through it right now. And I'm going to tell you why. Who's God going to take to heaven? Who's he going to take to heaven? Somebody he can depend on. Somebody he can trust. Somebody will show up if he tells them to. Hallelujah. He's not going to be fooling around with lukewarm questions. He don't have no time for a lukewarm question. What did the lukewarm Christian do in the church of Laodicea? He said, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. Either you for me, you on fire for me, or you cold as an old sweet potato. They wrote a song about that one time. Boy, that wasn't that an interesting, beautiful song, take an old cold potato and wait. And people are shouting on crazy stuff like that right there. Did you ever sing that to Thurston? How many times you heard that? Glory, hallelujah. Them old cold taters weren't much. They was pretty good though, when you put some butter on them and got them warm. Glory be to God. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Blessed be his holy precious name. Hallelujah. All right, verse 14. Nebuchadnezzar spoke and said unto them, it is true, old Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, do not you serve my gods and worship the golden images which I have set up? Now notice what he said there. My God. My God. How many people today are serving their God? The God that don't exist. The God they want to exist. You're going to bow to my God. You're going to do what I say. What is Joe Biden doing? He just sent another eviction notice out. No, you're not going to be evicted. People own all kinds of properties. They're not getting one penny's rent in certain places. They're paying them $3,700 a month to stay at home, but they don't even have to pay no rent. What are they doing? They're buying what they want. They're buying what they want. Hallelujah. We see all this taking place. Who's going to stand for God? Who's going to stand for righteousness? Who's going to stand for holiness? If God can't depend on his church, who can he depend on? If his church don't stand up, who's going to stand up? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When people today, where's their faith at? What do they believe in? Hallelujah. I had the advice, me and Donna had it. Dee, she brought her something. It took care of it. Glory be to God. They had a clinic up there in Cleveland that said, if you've had it once, don't worry about it. Your body's immune to it. Why do they keep pushing it? It's about control. What is behind this? The Antichrist is behind this. Most everybody talks about the mark of the beast. They don't understand what the mark of the beast really is. The mark of the beast is the world religion. But the number is of a man. Read the 18th verse of Revelation chapter 13. It's a man going to institute this number. He's going to come on the scene, and he's going to tell you what you can buy, what you can sell, what you can trade, what you can do. Is it in the process right now? If you can't see that, everybody's got to be blind. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Good friend of mine just got back from Venezuela. He was married to a woman down there, and this is kind of mind-boggling. The religion down there called some kind of religion down there. And they didn't believe in God. He said, well, I believe in God. His wife said, you better get out of here while you're alive. He said, without you? She said, yeah. He said, if you say something about Jesus Christ, your days are numbered, bud. That's right across the border. How many is coming in here from across the border? Have that belief. They don't believe in Jesus. They won't accept Jesus. They don't want to have anything to do with Jesus. They poured through into our country. What would they do to you and I? These people will serve a God, whatever the God they wanted to be. They'll serve it to the best of their ability. These three boys, they stood for the God. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, whose name is Jehovah, and his name is the Messiah. What does the Messiah mean? Means the anointed one has come, and they rejected him. Glory be to God. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Blessed be his holy, precious name. Verse 15 says, now, if you be ready at the time when you hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, I can't get that one. And all the kinds of music you follow and worship the image which I have made well. But if you worship not, you shall be cast in the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hand? He asked them a question. You don't bow when the music starts. Who is this God that's going to deliver you from out of my hands? Can you see the devil right there in that man? Who's going to deliver you out of my hands? Who is this God I'm going to have to serve? Oh, hallelujah. He's about to see a rude awakening a little bit on down that road there. But what did God do to this man named Nebuchadnezzar? Look over in chapter 4 and verse 16. He gave him the heart of a beast. Think about that. He gave him the heart of a beast. He thought like an animal. He had the same attributes as an animal. He didn't care about nobody. He has no compassion for nobody. What kind of compassion does an animal have when it comes to something they want? John had a pit bull down there and a coon hound. A bone was laid out there. The coon hound had it for a while, then the pit bull wanted it. They fit all day long. The pit bull told the other ones, aye. They done about kill one another over what? A bone. That's the tenacity of it. That's what they think like. When God turns people over to a mind like that, what kind of mind is that? When a man can do the things they're doing right now. I saw on Facebook yesterday they had a funeral in New York. As soon as they got out of the funeral home, a woman walked up and killed the guy's ex-wife. He tried to take him away from me. Shot her in the back of the head. This is the mindset you see in people today. I just read a while ago what the Treasury is talking about now, sending out digital dollars. All this is right here before us. This should strike a fear in the people of God. What does the book of Revelation say? Let him read this book. It is a blessing to him that reads this book and understands this book, because it's a revealing of what's coming. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. The Lord showed me this week, he said, what can you do without me? You've been praying for rain, have you seen any? You've been praying for this, have you seen anything? Do you really trust me for anything? Are you really believing me this thing? It shook me inside of me. I started thinking, Lord, am I thinking, I got to get like that song. Lord, I can't make it on my own. Hallelujah. Lord, I can't climb that mountain. I can't do it without you. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. If the church don't get on her knees and start believing God, I mean, all around the world, what's going to happen? Glory be to God. Hallelujah. They're serving that God they want to serve. Most of them are serving what they want to receive. Nobody's satisfied with the house they got. They're not satisfied with this, not satisfied with that. Materialistic things is not going to heaven. I'm going to tell you why, because 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 8 says, you brought nothing to this world, and you're certain to carry nothing out. Mama used to fuss at daddy because you didn't have no teeth. He said, I ain't spending all that money on a set of pair of old teeth. She kept on. He said, me tell you something, old gal, I didn't bring no teeth in here, and I ain't carrying none out of here. So it has to be by teeth. You're going to depend on two people when you're born. One, somebody's going to wash you. When a baby is born, what's the first thing they're doing? They take them back there and wash them up, put them little things on the head, this, that, and the other. What's the last thing they do? Hallelujah. Somebody washes you before they lay you in that coffin. Glory be to God. See, everybody needs help. Everybody needs somebody. Praise the Lord. Glory be to God. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. All right, verse 16. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered to the king Nebuchadnezzar, "We are not careful to even answer in this matter." What that means is I ain't a bit more studying about what you said, the man in the moon. If somebody tells me there's no God, forget it, bud. We ain't gonna discuss that one bit. Glory be to God. Who do you think made everything is here? Glory be to God. But I love verse 17. "If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fire furnace, and he will deliver us out of the hand, O king." And what's these three boys saying? Our God is going to deliver us out of your hand. You may throw us in that furnace. You may think you've got us rid of us. You may think all this and that and other. But we serve a miracle-working God. How many people believe that?
Amen.
The greatest miracles ever happened in your life is when Jesus saved you.
Amen.
That is the greatest miracle you'll have. Without that miracle taking place, we are not going to heaven. Oh, hallelujah. And I'm not going to put something in front of God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So what these three boys tell him? They looked at him. "You going to throw us in our heart? Don't make no difference, king. You don't control us. You don't have the power over us. We have a God. Hallelujah. It's that y'all done brought us into exile out of Israel, out of our home country. You tried to change us. You tried to do this. You tried to feed us. You tried to clothe us. You tried to do this, that, and other. But you're not going to take our God away from us." Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory be to God. How many young teenagers today would know that? Most everybody thinks this story about Daniel and the lion's den, and what Brother Hugh Boys and the lion's den is some kind of allegorical story. It's a metaphor. No, this really happened. How do you think Nebuchadnezzar got people under his bondage? You mess up, throw them in a furnace. What did the Medes and Persians do? Cut their heads off. What does Alexander the Great do? Run a sword through them. What did the Roman Empire do? Hang them on a cross. Now what do we have? If you go to certain parts of the world and you say Jesus is Lord and Savior, if you're not right with God, you're going to be crucified, or you're going to be beheaded. Don't tell us what will happen to you. Travel the world and see what goes on. Glory be to God. But they had a ready made up mind. Their faith was so strong and powerful in them, they were looking death in the eye. Looking death in the eye. How does our faith grow? Romans 10:17. Faith cometh by hearing, hearing cometh by the word of God. The only time your faith will grow is when you start listening to the word of God, you read the word of God, and you minister the word of God. If you can't minister to nobody else, minister to yourself. That's why David said, "I meditate on the Lord day and night that I would not sin against him." It's more the word you get into your spirit inside of you, you get more to battle the devil with. And next time a devil comes knocking at your door, you tell him, "Greater is he that's within me than he that's in the world." The devil can't stay where the Holy Spirit is at. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. But you've got to understand, the powers of darkness will come to you as an angel of light. He'll fool you. He'll trick you. And he's tricking the world today into believing, oh, all this what's going on, it's nothing wrong with it. What happened to every empire? Babylon had the gold. They failed. Medes and Persians had the silver. They failed. Greece and the empire, they went down real fast. They wound up with the bronze. Don't bring much. What happened to the mighty Roman Empire? They had two legs of iron. And all they did was kill. Iron won't bend. It breaks. But God broke it. He broke it. He broke it. The next empire will be the revived Roman Empire, which would be 10 toes of clay and iron. And he says, there's one coming out of Zion, a stone that's going to roll, and it's going to make that one crumble. Because Jesus Christ, when he comes on the scene, hallelujah, every knee is going to bow, every tongue is going to confess to the glory of God the Father. And especially those that's sold out to him and followed him. And you think about over there in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 13 says, "He that endureth to the end, the same shall be saved." But one of the saddest verses in the Bible is verse 12. For the love of many, where iniquity abounds, the love of many has waxed cold. Now really get that verse of scripture. Where iniquity abounds, that means that hidden sin, they won't ask for forgiveness. It's people today hadn't spoke to one another for years because of the hardness of their heart, because they have unforgiveness in their life. They can carry it to the grave. It'll carry them to hell. How many times did Peter say, Lord, how many times we forgive somebody? Jesus said, well, Peter, what do you think about it? He said, what about 7 times a day, Lord? He said, I added 70 to that, Peter. Peter looked at him with astonishing. He was like, Jethro, what do you mean? That's 490 times a day. If you need to be. Why? So you can make it to glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When we think about everything that's going on today, why somebody get mad and kill somebody over any least little thing? Man called me last night and said his friend went to this boy's house and got to arguing over something. He stuck a butcher knife in him. And when that went downtown and tried to finish him off, and they almost finished him off. Violence. Rage. And somebody tells you they love you? Oh, my God, hallelujah. Verse 18, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve your God nor worship your golden images which thou hast set up. Then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury in the form of his vintage and changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Therefore, and spake and commanded them they should heat the furnace 7 times more than it ever had been heat before. And somebody asked me that question one time, said, how could I heat that furnace 7 times hotter? I have no idea. I don't know what they was using, coal or wood or what they was holding. But anyway, he said he wanted 7 times hotter than it ever been. The rage he had because these 3 boys wouldn't do something this simple. That's all they'd had to do. Not said a word, just bowed down. That right there is all they had done. And these bums, when the flag is being flown, they do this right here. They got no business in America. They don't know what a soldier is. They ought to go up. They'll have to be go sit to the VA about a week and watch what comes in and out over there to give them that freedom where they can bow on their knees. The only time you bow on your knees is to who? The Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, because he's worthy to be bowed for. Glory be to God. So this king, he's enraged. Look at these people today, enraged when you don't do what they tell them to do. Oh, they call themselves political parties. They political parties, all right. Hallelujah, hallelujah. All right. And he commanded the most mighty men that were in his army and bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the burning furnace. These men were bound with their coats and their hoses and their hats and their outer garments, they cast them into the midst of the burning furnace. Therefore, because the king commanded the urgency of the furnace exceeding hot, the flames and the fire slew the men that threw Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in. How'd you like to be in that army? How'd you like to have that command continue? Hallelujah. If they didn't do it, they'd throw them in. This is how ruthless they were. All right. That dropped down to verse 25. I love this one. And he answered and said, lo, I see 4 men loose walking in the midst of the fire. And they had no hurt. And the form of the 4th is like the Son of Man. And what happened here? Their faith got them in the fire. Glory be to God. But who was there before they got there? The 4th man. And how in the world did a ruthless, hateful, arrogant, self-righteous, you could call him all kind of names, king, know who the 4th man was? God dropped him right there where he was at and said, look at here, bud. Let me show you some power. You can throw my children in a furnace, But I'll send my son, and he'll protect them. It won't be one hair sitting on their head, and they'll come out shouting and praising and glorifying him. And I'll make you think you a cow after eating green grass, got wings on your back like feathers, and you'll be as crazy as a bat, won't even know where you's at. Glory be to God. And you go come against my children? When God's children will stand. Hallelujah. Romans 8:31 said, if God be for us, who can be against us? There's not a force in hell that can destroy one child of God. But we've got to stand. We've got to stand, no matter what it is. See how your faith will carry you through? If you have the faith of the grain of the size of a mustard seed, he said you can speak to that mountain in your life. And a lot of us have mountains. We think we have mountains. A lot of people today is living on fear. Is living in fear. They think they have nothing going for them. They don't have nothing to turn to. Every time they go to a doctor, drop another pill down their mouth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We need the power of the Holy Ghost in our life. Glory be to God. We need the power that these three young boys had. And what happened to Daniel? When Daniel, they told him not to pray. He went up on his second story, high as he could get, and opened the window and prayed. Glory be to God. Don't feed your lions for a week. It doesn't make any difference. He made a pillow out of a lion. Glory, hallelujah, to the Lamb of God. What's so important about these men like that? There's a man named Noah. There's a man named Job. There's a man named Daniel. And Ezekiel 14:14 says, all three of these men are sitting in heaven today. Why? Because of their faith. Because they serve that awesome God. And don't doubt these three boys is up around the throne right now. Praise, glory be unto God. Hallelujah. They would not bow. They would not bend. They would not give in. And they could have had all kind of wealth. They were like Moses. They turned down the best that they had. Glory, hallelujah. But what meant more to them than all that wealth and all that power and that prestige and a certain name? Almighty God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We can't make it by ourselves. The mountain's too high, the valley's too wide. But when you get down on your knees, hallelujah. Every time Joshua would get a battle, win a battle, he'd say, let's make an altar. Let's make an altar. Let's make an altar. Glory, hallelujah. When he got to the promised land, only 10 tribes made it across to Jordan. They didn't like going any further. They didn't see what they wanted. They're satisfied. A lot of people satisfied where they at. But back in that day and time, in the 16th chapter of the book of Leviticus, when you went to the tabernacle, if you didn't take something, each year it was a cleansing. And those that brought something, especially a lamb, it was slain for you. And the blood covered you. If you didn't take nothing, you was cut off from your blessings of God. What is God doing to America today? He's going to cut it off. And I always remember this. He said the wheat and tares will grow together. What does that mean? That's the righteous and the wicked. But in 25th, to the book of Matthew, he said, I'll separate them. I, who is I? Almighty God. Matthew chapter 16 and verse 27 says, every man will have to be judged according to his works. Hallelujah, hallelujah. That's why Luke said, are you worthy? Will you be worthy to be called a child of God? Read the 21st chapter of the book of St. Luke. When you see all these things begin to happen, but fires, famines, sickness and disease, earthquakes, volcanoes, floods. Look up. Your redemption draweth nigh. Then men are going to look up and their hearts going to fail them. They're going to have a heart attack. You think you've seen something terrible down here now. Wait till people start dying. Then you get on to Revelation, long about chapter 11. They're going to be seeking death and can't die. They're going to be stung by adders for 7 months. Like being bit by a snake. They're going to be seeking death. They're going to be pleading and begging and praying to die. Jump off of cliffs and can't die. Then they're going to be like a mole. They're going to try to get in a cave. They're going to try to get in a cave to hide from his coming. But he says in Revelation 1 and 6, every eye is going to behold me. Every hand is going to see me. And those that pierce my hands and my feet. And how precise is that? He said, I remember the man that helped me and put me on that cross. I remember what they said about me. I remember they drove it nailed in my hands. I remember they put on my feet. I remember that high priest come up and made fun of me and laughed at me. I remember the kids to put up on me. They will bow before me. They will bow in my presence, and I'll tell them where they're going to spend eternity. All these people make it out like, oh, we got all this power, this, that, and other. Talking about the president's the most powerful man in the world. No, he's not. The most powerful force in this world is the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
It's Almighty God. Without you, we can't do nothing. Glory be to God. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. So how strong is your faith today? We all have to ask that question. Have I done enough to make it? Am I living the way God wants me to live? With every head bowed and every eye closed. What will happen right after the rapture takes place? If you left here, your faith is going to really be tried. If you received a mark in your right hand, on your forehead, you signed yourself a death warrant to hell. Will you be able to stand up and say, cut my head off or kill me any way you so choose to? So you want to put to the test of that. When it's so easy right now to accept Jesus and live for him. I'm not talking about some great spectacular. You do flying across the world and this and that and the other. I'm talking about living for Jesus day to day. People take his name in vain and laugh about it. They call on him and call him everything but the Savior. They make fun of him. This so-called rap music. My boy, Jesus. Can you imagine Jesus want to listen to something like that? Where will you spend eternity? See, God holds everything, Brother Thurston. He said, I know the day you're going to die. I know how you're going to die. I know where you're going to die. And I know what you're going to die of. And I know when it's going to happen. It's nothing you can do about it. It's nothing at all you can do about it. I know where you're going to spend eternity. If you follow me and serve me, I'm going to take you to my heaven. I'm going to take you to a place where there will never be as much as one thought, even think about a tear drop. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's a many people sitting at home this morning for whatever reason, whatever excuse they come up with. God will not accept no excuses. Only the pure in heart and the clean in hand is going to make it to glory. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. There are three people sitting in here right now. You're lonely, you don't know hardly what to do with yourself. You know, nobody fix that is God. Every day you feel so lonely. Lord, why am I still here? Why is this going on in my life? Loneliness is a horrible thing. And the devil is doing that to you. The devil is doing that to you. He don't want you to have no joy. But if you'll just lift up your heart right now and say, Lord, I need some joy. I done cried enough this week. I done doubted long enough. I done went without long enough. I don't want to have to live like this, Lord. Help me overcome it. Give me life worth living. And he will. And he will. It was like Hannah. Hannah was barren. And she said, Lord, could I please have a child? Could I please have a baby? And her husband said, Hannah, what's wrong with you? She said, I'm grieving. I'm not a full woman till I have me a baby. I want a baby. And God gave her that baby. And she said, Lord, I'll dedicate him back to the work of your ministry. I'll give it back to you, Lord. Just let me have it for a while. Hallelujah! And if then her life was full of joy. She got what she needed to carry her through the storms of life. George Jones wrote a song about his mama. He said he didn't realize it. In 1965, I started drinking. I started worrying mama. Now, all these years, I put burdens on mama. Daddy left mama with two kids. How's mama gonna make it? All the love mama had for her babies. The love mama had for her babies. And he said, will you be out doing this, that, and all that? No worship. We were there. And staggering, and mama be praying. Thank God he made it whole. Thank God he made it whole. I can relate to that. I can relate to that. Thank God for praying, mama. Thank God for praying, church. Thank God for praying, brother and sister. You got something valuable when you got to pray it like that. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory be to God. The loneliness will leave if you fill your heart with God. He'll put joy back in. The first gift of the Spirit is love, peace, and joy. Glory be to God. That's what the world needs today. It's some love, it's some peace, and some joy. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory be to God. Right where you're sitting right now, you just lift up your hand and say, Lord, give me that. Give me that. Don't be ashamed. You just say, Lord, give it to me. Give it to me. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He'll give it to you. Glory, hallelujah. He'll take all the worry and doubt and fear out of your life. Because there's nothing we can do about it. He's the way maker. He's the everlasting Father. He's the Prince of Peace. He's the mighty counselor. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He'll stir inside of you something that's awesome. And every one of us needs to be filled with the Holy Ghost. If you've never spoken in tongues, you need to seek it. You're going to need it. You're going to need it. It's a booster shot. It'll help you in that midnight hour. It'll help you in that dark hour. Because Romans 8:26 says, there'll be a time when you'll be so burnt down you can't even. Won't nothing come out of your mouth. I've been there. I know what it is. And the Holy Ghost to pray through you and for you, you'll leave a whole lot better. I was thinking about giving up. I made up my mind I'm going back to church. It went 9 months. But that night, God came to me. He filled me with the Holy Spirit. That's the last time I ever thought about quitting. Because I know what I had found. I seen a man stand with a white robe on. I didn't see no face, but I know it was Jesus. And he said, come to me, come to me, come to me. And if you need him right now, just come to him. Come to him. He'll take care of what's wrong in your life. He'll make your life worth living. He'll give you what nobody else can. Because he says in Isaiah 61, he has anointed me. He has anointed me to bind up the brokenhearted. How many's hearts are broke today? How many of us hearts have been broke over family members and children and things of that nature? Our hearts have been broken. But he can fix it. He's the only one who can fix it. He set the captive free. And a lot of people's mind this morning, they still bound in their mind because they never been really set free. They haven't really trusted Jesus. Hallelujah. He will set the captive free. He'll set the captive free. Whom the Son of God sets free is free indeed. From John 8:32. If you need some from him today, would you come let me agree with you? It doesn't make any difference what it is. He is able. He is able. Robert, I want you to come stand in for a man's wife. He told me last night she's sick. She can't play the piano no more. She can't sing no more. She's a piano in church. I want everybody to reach y'all's hand toward me this morning. Heavenly Father, I pray today for Eugene Brown. Lord, I pray that you'll anoint his hand and reach down and touch that lady. Lord, if she can still run the keys of that keyboard. Lord, I pray that you put back in her heart and joy and song and peace and comfort. Lord, I pray for you to take away the sufferings in her body today. All the lonely people, all the people going through trials, tents, heartaches over certain things. Lord, they're sitting at home this morning. They don't know what to do with themselves. They don't know what to do. They can't sleep. They can't get no peace. They can't get no understanding of anything in it. All they got to do is come unto you. Come unto me. All you labor and heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Glory be to God. Hallelujah to the Lamb of Almighty God. If they'll do that, all they got to do is come to you. And they'll leave with a peace of mind. It's guaranteed in the Word of Almighty God. World's on fire, God's word will still stand. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We thank you today. today, Heavenly Father, for what you're going to do. So many people across this county really need this special touch. Lord, we bring Betty Dent before you right now, Lord, to heal her body. She wants to be in God's hands. Lord, give her the means and the strength to go forward. And we pray that your anointed hand reach right there in her house where she's at. Reach out to every household in Franklin County today, Lord Jesus. Touch them by your spirit and by your power. Just the faith is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego have, that we will say no to the King of this world, and yes to the Holy Spirit of Almighty God. For it's in your gracious name we pray. Faith is going to be tried. It's going to be tested. But if you hold to Him, your faith may carry you into a problem, but it'll bring you out of the problem. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. The anointing will break every yoke in your life, every bondage. So many people today have got a yoke around their neck. They got a weight they carry. They don't need it. Says, bring it to the altar and do it. Pick up your gift. Pick up your gift. Pick up your gift. What you need. God will give you that gift. He has 23 of them. And one of them will work. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we pray with the power of your anointing hand. Lord, as the enemy is trying to destroy her mind through fear and doubt and everything he possibly can. There was a man that wrote his infant son and said, my son is dying. Father, can you do something? Jesus asked him his question. He said, can you pray? He said, no, Father, I can't pray. Then he prayed. The boy was healed. And he said, God, help me. Lord Jesus, help me by night, my unbelief. And from now on, I can trust you and believe before you. And Lord, we believe it right now. We believe it right now for a miracle. Carrying burdens. If you don't have a halt at home, you can make it anywhere. If you feel depressed, man, it's on a Friday. Listen, every time I get depressed, I'll pick the word of God. That depression will leave me just like that. Why? Because that word is alive. In the book of Colossians, he said, when you speak the word, you're speaking life. To somebody, they accept Jesus. You spoke life into them. That's what a child of God can do. That's what a child of God can do. I hear people say, is there any miracles left in the church? I was asked this question last night. I have seen miracles. I know there's miracles. I know God can do. God love you. Every one of you. And I pray this will be a week that you'll have, knowing Jesus, a more deeper relationship with Him, and a more closer walk with Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Glory be to God. Little John, stand, dismiss us in prayer, please, sir. Let me tell you this. Read the only Bible somebody will ever see. It's what you tell them. You always remember that. That's a fact. Sometimes you're the only Bible they ever hear. It's what you tell them. That's why he said, be a witness to me. Hallelujah.